organize it so that we have our hygienists, who are the only preventionists left in all of healthcare. They're the only relationship where people come to you well on a regular basis. And so what we want is the hygienist to be able to flag some of these things, and our team does such a great job. Amy's in there every day looking for how she can help patients get healthier by looking more carefully at their health. And so this is a guide for her, and then she can use screening tools as well. And then what we do from there is, I guess this is the third page, right? No? Oh, I was just showing. Oh, so when we use, we have a flag in there, then we use another assessment tool so we come up with more information. And that's selfscreen.net. I'm not going to go into there. But these letters of advocacy, we write them for all kinds of conditions, including active periodontal disease. One of the ways to educate the physicians in your community about oral health is to report to the physicians about their lack of oral health and what ramifications those have on overall body health. The other thing is that you, when you start to learn how to look at metabolic disease and what shows up in the mouth, you know, diabetes and reflux and chronic systemic inflammation from food sensitivities and nutrient deficiencies and sleep apnea, when you start to recognize these things, you're going to want to report them to their physicians. It is our responsibility and it's our opportunity to help educate the rest of our community, the healthcare professionals in our area, and to bring them on board. When they get interesting letters from a dentist, guess what? They have to read this. Legally, they have to read it. So if it's sitting on their desk and they're looking through labs because their labs are just pretty boring and they get a letter like this, they're like, whoa. Dear, this is written last week, September 7th, actually. I had the pleasure of seeing our mutual patient, Paul Schmidt, for a comprehensive dental exam. I understand from Paul that he had a stroke in August 2019 that was not attributed to any known risk factors. I wanted to alert you to some of my concerns. Paul has chronic active periodontal disease with bone loss and chronic inflammation. To best treat Paul's, now he's already had a stroke. This wasn't picked up. This isn't picked up by the vascular neurologist or the cardiologist. No one's ever asked him in the cardiologist's office. It says, to best treat him, I rely on oral DNA laboratory to identify from a saliva sample specific pathogens associated with this disease as well as antibiotic adjunctive therapy for those pathogens. We also use the sample to assess the genetic factors he may possess that influence his systemic ability to fight inflammation and infection. He's positive for interleukin-1, interleukin-6, indicating intermediate acquired risk of periodontal disease and cardiovascular disease. He has 10 of the 11 most significant pathogens associated with periodontal disease. See the enclosed report. Now, that sounds like I know a whole lot of stuff, doesn't it? Well, I get that right off the report. Right off the oral DNA report. Easy to do. With periodontal disease, we recognize the causative relationship between those pathogens and cardiovascular disease events, both MI and CVA, attaching the evidence. MI and CVA, these are the words they use. Not stroke and heart attack. They might call it a cardiovascular accident. Is that what you call it? CVA?
Yeah, MI and CVA.
Yeah, MI and CVA. Periodontal disease shares a bidirectional relationship to his type 2 diabetes, each making the other worse. Note that his A1C level on 5/17/21 in our office was 6.7 from a fingerstick blood test analyzed by using a calibrated instrument, the Siemens DCA analyzer. So we're doing the diabetes testing right there. Per Paul's salivary diagnostic profile, we're prescribing metronidazole and amoxicillin in conjunction with his full mouth disinfection to help him stabilize the disease. Our aim is to create a significant shift in the profile of his oral microbiome. In reviewing Paul's sleep structure, we discussed the idea of a baseline sleep study to rule out undiagnosed sleep disorder. Some of his OSA symptoms are insomnia and erectile dysfunction. Paul's physical and physiologic signs are hypertension, Mallampati score of 3, scalloped tongue, class 2 posterior tongue tie, bruxism, noted wear on his anterior teeth from posturing forward. Exploring a definitive OSA diagnosis, we referred him to Midwest Sleep Center for a complete sleep study. We appreciate partnering with you in our community. With you, we are helping people with a root cause analysis of these chronic lifestyle-related diseases. If we can be of further help, please let us know. I would love an opportunity to speak to your colleagues or your care team in a formal or informal setting regarding these oral systemic links in the spirit of working together. Now, I'm going to ask you, if you are a physician, we have a physician, if you got a letter like this from a dentist, right? Wow. And it's like, someone knows what she's talking about in dentistry. So you might start referring some patients to me with patients that you have that you want to be, and that's how we create a network. Now,